Hello and welcome to our service for Sunday the 14th of August 2022. I don't know how it is with you, but it's getting warm down here again. We're in our second heat wave within a few weeks. This one is going to last a little bit longer, but it isn't quite so warm, thankfully. That said, we are also in the middle of something of a drought, we are told, having hosepipe bans and things of that nature, which makes life very difficult, especially with the kids out there trying to enjoy their summer holidays. We still need rain, and pray God we get some. But our God, who made this entire planet for us to look after, who gave us everything wonderful in it, is still in command, and we bow to him. He is indescribable. He is uncontainable. He is all-powerful, and he is untamable. So come on, let's sing our first worship song together, from the highest of heights to the depths of the sea. Praise his name.
From the highest of high to the depths of the sea, creation's revealing your majesty. From the colors of fall to the fragrance of spring, every creature unique and the soul that is, all exclaiming, indescribable, uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing. And all powerful, untamable, awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim, you are amazing. Told every lightning bolt where you should go, or seen heavenly storehouses laden with snow. Who imagined the sun gives source to its light, yet conceals it to bring us the coolness of night.
my heart and you love me the same. You are amazing. You see the depths of our hearts and you love us the same.
Praise his name. That is a wonderful song, isn't it? And I hope you were singing along to it. You should know it well enough by now to be able to do that with your hands in the air, maybe. I don't know. Let's open our service in prayer. Heavenly Father, we live in the reality of you being that indescribable God, that limitless God. And Father, we just bow before you because we know that we are so limited. You are so unlimited, and you have all power and all knowledge. And Father, we ask you today, right now, at the very beginning of this service, Lord, that you will help us to worship you in the awe of who you are, to become closer to you, to hear your word, and be doers of it. In Jesus' name, amen. So we're going to sing again straight away. This song is good. It's been requested by somebody for this week, and I'm delighted to be able to include it in the service. It's good to get requests because then you know that it's not just my choices that you're hearing all the time. If you've got a song you'd like us to play, then please just let us know and I'll do my best to incorporate it in the service if I possibly can. This is wonderful. Hosanna. Praise is rising.
Stirring.
told you that was a lovely song, didn't I? Maybe you were singing along with it already. Maybe you knew it before. I don't know. Let's read from the Word of God. This is the Gospel of Luke. It's chapter 20. It's verses 20 down to 26. Keeping a close watch on him, Jesus, they, the religious leaders, sent spies who pretended to be sincere. They hoped to catch Jesus in something he had said, so that they might hand him over to the power and authority of the governor. So the spies questioned him, "Teacher, we know that you speak and teach what is right, and that you do not show partiality, but teach the way of God in accordance with the truth. Is it right for us to pay taxes to Caesar or not?" He saw through their duplicity and said to them, "Show me a denarius. Whose image and inscription are on it?" "Well, Caesar's," they replied. And he said to them, "Then give back to Caesar what is Caesar's, and give to God what is God's." They were unable to trap him in what he had said there in public, and astonished by his answer, they became silent. He has made me glad. How beautiful is that song? He is our refuge, he is our tower, he is our strength, and we depend on him in the storms of life. I'm sure you will agree. So here in this Bible story that we just read, we have another Machiavellian attempt by the Jewish law teachers and chief priests to catch Jesus out. It wasn't the first time, and it wouldn't be the last. They sent undercover spies to listen to him and to trap him. Like that was ever going to work. Did you notice the kind of smoochy language they used for him? Telling him all the kind of things you'd expect him to want to hear. Lord, you teach the truth without bias, all that kind of stuff. But Jesus saw right through their shenanigans and gave them one of the most iconic replies that we have in the scripture. That said, the question that the spies asked was actually quite a good one. And it often crops up in our lives. Is it right? We actually face the is it right question on pretty much a daily basis in our own lives. We're making little decisions about what shopping we should get, or life-changing decisions about things like jobs and homes and relationships, things of that nature. Now, although this story is Jesus avoiding a trap, the truths of it remain the same. Whose image is it on the coin of our lives? What value do we represent? And what inscription is there placed upon us? What message are we given? Are we giving to other people? So it is right that in our lives we ask the question, is it right? The question posed to Jesus was not about whether Romans ought to pay tax to Caesar, that was a given. It was about whether Jews should, being the people of God. For the Jews, it was about sovereignty. For the Jew, it was about who are you loyal to, Rome or Israel? And this was the trap that they set him. Say yes to paying tax to Rome and he's no Jew, and he loses all credibility. Say no to Rome and trouble with the Romans was bound to follow, no doubt with those selfsame Jews stirring it up for him on that count. By the way, he had disciples wanting him to overthrow Rome as well, so they would have undoubtedly been very interested in the answer that he was giving, I expect. He skillfully avoided controversy because for Jesus it was actually about priority. Doing what was right as a citizen, but without compromising the spiritual loyalty. Give to Caesar that which is Caesar. Give to God that which is God's. Now I'm speaking primarily to believers today. And it is an issue of setting our spiritual priorities right with that question, is it right, on the forefront of our minds. Asking the same questions about the issues in our lives as they unfold. We ought to be able to distinguish between what is of God and what is not, and to respond accordingly. Now, I love that Jesus encouraged his disciples to be wise and not to be taken in by the spurious. We need to do that as well. This is a verse that you should hang on to. It's a wonderfully descriptive verse. Matthew 10:16. Jesus said, I am sending you out like sheep among wolves. Therefore, be as shrewd as snakes and as innocent as doves. So there you have it. We are sheep, we are snakes, and we are doves. And we need to know how to use those personas to be wise in this world. It is why there is a gift of discernment given to us, to discern whether or not the Spirit of God is in something or someone. It is why there is a phrase in the communion service protocol laid down by the Apostle Paul that we are encouraged to examine ourselves before we take the bread, before we take the wine. Why? Because examining ourselves for all that is right is the right thing to do. One of the hallmarks of the believer should be that we are able to distinguish between what is of God and what is not, and therefore be distinguishable from the world around us. As the coin Jesus asked for showed who it belonged to, so our lives should show who we belong to, unequivocally. The illustration of the coin in this story is one to remember because it had a value, it had an image, and it had an inscription. The value of our Christianity is not found in how good it makes us feel, although praise God we feel good being Christians. There is a tendency sometimes to think that Christianity is nothing more than a benefits package, peace, love, everlasting life, etc. Now praise God for the guarantee of all those things and say a big amen. But, and there is a huge but, the real value is in the difference it makes to us, not the difference it makes for us. Think about that. John 5:14, when Jesus healed the man at the pool of Bethesda, Jesus said to him, "See, you are well again." That was the benefit. But the gain was in him saying, "Stop sinning." In John 8:11, similarly, when Jesus met the woman caught in adultery in another trap set for him, the benefit was that he asked her, "Who condemns you?" She said, "No one." The gain was that he asked her to go and sin no more, to change her life, to change the man at Bethesda's life by giving them a new way of doing things. The true value of Christianity, in short, has two outworkings that I'm going to say today. There are plenty of others that you could read up on as well. The first is godliness. 1 Timothy 4:8, "For physical training is of some value, but godliness has value for all things, holding promise for both the present life and the life to come." We are called to be godly, especially when the world seems to be less and less godly at every turn. We are to be the beacons of light that Scripture requires us to be. We are required to be truth in people's lives and to show the attributes of God through His image on the coin of our lives. Then there is faith. Galatians 5:6, "For in Christ Jesus neither circumcision or uncircumcision has any value. The only thing that counts is faith expressing itself through love." At least on this occasion, Paul has it that the most important thing is that our faith expresses itself through love. We need both of those things, faith and love, as well as godliness. So I ask you, is that right? If godliness, faith, and love are indicators of our salvation, how much of that do we show? How much value do we represent in the lives that we live amongst those who we are called to live with? You see, the ultimate value of a coin is determined by how much it will buy. I don't know if you've ever listened to the news broadcast and they talk about the exchange rates. I don't know whether you understand that or not. Sometimes it goes right over my head. But we all know the reality of the fact that if we can buy something with our pound coin this week that we can't buy with that same pound next week, that our pound is not worth as much as it was. But I'll tell you something. We are not coins in God's economy to be saved up. We are coins to be spent. Spent in bringing others to Christ. Our value is diminished if we are hidden under the proverbial bushel, if we are buried in the ground, or put into some kind of spiritual piggy bank for a rainy day that might not ever happen. We need to be used of God now. The second thing that's obvious about a coin is the image that is upon it. The denarius shown to Jesus had the face of Caesar Augustus on it, as you can see behind me. That was, as is now, a demonstration of who the coin belongs to. Now, of course, we have the profile of Queen Elizabeth II on that coin to most directly show you the sovereignty of the nation that it belongs to. We need to ensure that when people look at our lives, they can see who it is that we belong to. that we do not conform to this world, that we have been transformed from it, and that the image of God is there on our lives for all to see. 1 John 4:17. In this way, love is made complete among us, so that we will have confidence on the day of judgment. In this world, we are like him. How beautiful is that? How absolutely wonderful is that? It's quite a challenge though, isn't it? To be like him in this world. Now, please don't get this wrong. We have to fit into the world. So there is nothing wrong with dressing like our peers, enjoying the music that our peers might enjoy, if that's our thing as well, being part of the culture around us. No one is calling us to be weird. Some of us don't need any help on that front. We are weird enough as it is. But we must be imitators of God. And if there is a clash between what God wants for us and what is going on in the world, we must always cling to what he wants. Absolutely, first and foremost. That includes everything, from bypassing movies or TV programs whose morality is not godly morality, to refusing to join in with anything around us that does not love our neighbor. We bear his image. Now, not until the second coming comes will we fully be like him when we see him face to face. But for now, that image of his on our lives is enough for us to represent him in this world. Lastly, there is the inscription. The inscription we bear as coins in the master's treasury is his word. That is his moniker. That is his signature. But it isn't just that the word of God is to be stored in the heart. As I said earlier, we are not coins for saving up. We are coins to be spent. So that word of God is to be proclaimed. It's time for a little bit of Jeremiah. Jeremiah 20 verse 9, this is wonderful. His word is in my heart like a fire shut up in my bones. I am weary of holding it in. Indeed, I cannot. Isn't that great? We have the word of God in us, but we should not be holding it in. We should be proclaiming it to those around us. There is a beautiful story. If you've got time to give it a read, in 2 Chronicles 34, it's verses 14 to 33, when Hilkiah the priest found the lost book of the law that Moses had written centuries and centuries before. He passed it to Shaphan, the secretary, who in turn passed it on to the young king, Josiah, who eventually gave it back to the nation. Now, some of us are pretty good at hiding the word of God in our hearts, and that's great. It's good to do that at times, but it must also be shown to the world as an inscription on the coin of our lives. In just the way that Jeremiah couldn't hold it in any longer, we need to tell the world what the word of God is. It must be proclaimed. It must be lived. In 2 Timothy 4:2, Paul told Timothy to preach the word of God in season and out of season, which was really Paul just being very emotional and telling Timothy to always be ready to speak the word of God and to share the word of God through his life. This returns again to godliness as part of that inscription that we have. It is critical to living our lives as a Christian in the most successful way possible. It's not about legalism. It is about righteousness. So is it right for us to gather together regularly as church? Yes, it is. Is it right for us to be in the world but not of it? Yes, it is. Is it right for us to be salt and light to the people who we know? Yes, it is. Is it right to show righteousness in the way that we live? Yes, it is. Is it right to be full of the Holy Spirit? Yes, it absolutely is. So we render to Caesar by all means the things that we should render to Caesar. Never hold back on that. But we must make sure that it is God who is seen in and through the coin of our lives, and that when people encounter us, they can see the value of God because they can see the value that we have while we walk this earth.
I have a home, eternal home, but for now I walk this broken world. You walked it first, you know our pain, but you sure hope can rise again up from the grave. Abide with me, abide with me, don't let me fall, and don't let go. Walk with me and never leave. Ever close, God, abide with me. There in the night, Gethsemane, before the cross, before the nails, overwhelmed, alone you prayed. You met our sin, our suffering, and bore our shame. Abide with me, abide with me, don't let me fall, and don't let go. Walk with me and never leave. Ever close, God, abide with me. A love that will not ever let me go. Love that will not ever let me go. You never let me go. Love that will not ever let me go.
And up ahead, eternity, we'll weep no more and sing for joy. Abide with me.
We'll weep no more and sing for joy. Abide with me. Abide with me. Abide with me. Don't let me fall, and don't let go. Walk with me and never. Ever close, God, abide with me.
That's a beautiful, beautiful song, isn't it? And I just know that the Lord will abide with us, because that is his biblical promise to us. So Heavenly Father, I pray, Lord God, that as we enter this next week, Lord, that we will show the true value of our lives as Christians by having your face on our face, so to speak, by having your word on our lips, and by having your value shown through the values that we live by ourselves. Heavenly Father, give us the strength to do that, because sometimes it's not easy. Give us the tenacity to do that, because sometimes we need to find a way. Lord, give us the strength to do it, because it's easy to lose heart. Father, in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. And so we come to the end of another one of our services, and it's again for me to close by asking the Lord to bless you and keep you and make his face to shine upon you and give you his strength and his presence and his power. Amen. God.